Peter, I wanted to ask you a little bit about short-term bias. We tend to apply that to politicians, and we know that there's a challenge to get elected every 3 or 4 years, and that sometimes represents a challenge when it comes to long-term investments and long-term gains where the benefits are really not going to accrue until long after the politician in question is out of office. Pretty familiar with that. But you were saying earlier that that short-term bias applies to all of us as well. It's not just politicians.
It's interesting because one of the things that we do at the foundation is we look at environmental issues as we say, well, what are the barriers to achieving the type of environmental future that we would like? Mm-hmm. And a lot of that ends up going back to sort of cognitive issues, behavioral issues. How do you create the type of change in individuals that would actually help them embrace that? And what we do see over and over again is that short-term bias is, of course, it's endemic. It's across whether you're in business or government or just in a household. It's not surprising to understand why. If you can see, because we actually have imagination limits as to mm-hmm. how far out we can see. So you can see about where you want to be next year in a couple of years and the investment you can do. There's a more immediate connection between your decision to buy something or do something or make any decision and the outcome. When you get to longer term thinking, what happens is that you actually don't see the outcome. And if you can't see the outcome, you're going to be less likely to do it. Which is why it's so difficult for businesses and governments and even households to say, I'm going to make a decision that actually I'm going to be retired, I might even be dead by the time it actually comes to fruition, but I think it's the right thing to do. It's very tough to do that.
Mm-hmm. And yet we've heard a little bit today about the fact that most polling suggests that people want to do that. And there was some suggestion today that the real challenge is aligning our public policy goals and our public policy initiatives with the moral impulses that already exist out there in the public. That suggests a pretty optimistic view of people's commitment to sustainability. Do you share that view of people's commitment?
Well, I'm generally an optimist anyways. I think I'd have to be. But at the individual level, there is a challenge. And all of the polling would indicate that environment, notwithstanding this recession, for example, has continued to be an issue that deeply concerns Canadians. Mm-hmm. But what we're finding is it's also more aspirational than it is action-oriented. And when it actually gets to the decisions you actually have to make to actually achieve the aspiration that you would secretly believe in, that you start to see things slow down. And I think that's where you have to have a number of things happening at the same time. Aspiration alone isn't going to get us to the outcomes we want. You actually have to introduce things such as a bit of regulation, a bit of pricing mechanisms to drive behavioral change, and you have to sort of, and as well information and communications, not to mention networks that actually help get us there. So all of these pieces are needed, and I think this is actually a very important point. If we have the aspiration already there, and we do want to achieve it, but what we're missing is a little bit of the kick to actually get us going, then we're stuck with this notion that if governments reflect who we are, they're going to get frozen in the same thing while the people aren't asking for it. They're saying they want it, but they're actually not doing it. So it actually needs a whole bunch of folks to have a little bit of courage to say, on the regulatory side or on the incentive side, to say, actually, we're going to have to do this. Mm-hmm. And then on the individual side, when they start to see those things happen, say, okay, end of the party, I actually have to get on with it. And the best illustration I can use for that is, in fact, the introduction of the carbon tax in British Columbia. It was a highly divisive issue during the election, mm-hmm. And it was, it was actually portrayed as, a tax that would be regressive. And lo and behold, it became an issue in the election. People said, no, we can't do this. It's going to harm the economy. It's going to harm my household income. And yet, the election occurred. Was over, mm-hmm. The issue kind of went away. We're into the third year of a rolling implementing a new increase in the tax each year. On July the 1st, there'll be the next tranche of the tax. I would be surprised if there's any discussion at all about it. It's become actually embedded in people's thinking, and as a result of that, you're actually seeing businesses and governments and others who actually are impacted by it already making changes. They're smart enough to say, all right, by the year 2012, the tax is going to be here. I can make decisions now based on how I'm going to invest that reflect how I can reduce my carbon tax. Mm-hmm. So that's, you actually need a bit of that sort of, you have to overcome that initial reluctance to say, oh, we can't do it, it's going to harm us. And once you get over that barrier, you actually get more acceptance than you would believe.
Right. And it's striking to me that there's a bit of public policy courage that came from a government that's largely seen as a tax-cutting government, a pro-growth government. Mm-hmm. And that makes me wonder if some of the traditional lines that we've come to view the environment are breaking down. The old adversarial model between activist groups and NGOs on one side and big business on the other and government somewhere in between. Today's event, for example, is a partnership between Siemens, a big global corporation, David Suzuki Foundation, and our magazine. Do you see those that old adversarial model breaking down?
Well, I do, but we just need to clarify that a bit. What I do see is an emerging realization that the issues and challenges that we're dealing with are really quite important. Mm-hmm. And there is a timing issue here. The earlier we can begin to transition some of our energy systems and our transportation systems and how we live to a more sustainable future, the better. So at the level of environmental groups like the David Suzuki Foundation, there's this notion that we could just be a curmudgeon and just sort of fight this all the way, or we can say, look, we're all collectively in this, and we actually all have to find ways to address the challenges. And that's when the thinking says, okay, well, then we have to look at the role that business plays and the role that the NGO sector plays or the role that government plays and see where we can find the pieces that we can work together on. The caveat is that that you still need people to be honest and forthright when something is really not right. Mm-hmm. And what I would not want to have happen in this is that the environmental movement, if it moves to being more engaged with government and business, there will be a perception that somehow that they're captured by that and mm-hmm. they've lost their independence, and I've certainly heard those comments already. So the trick is to make sure that you can find a way. This is a maturing of how we work together. Mm-hmm. And the maturity would say that if somebody's doing something right and we see a way forward, we should find a way to work with them to find a solution. If, on the other hand, they're doing something that is clearly inappropriate, we should find a way to say, really, that's not the right thing to do. Mm-hmm. I think you can play both roles. The maturity would be that you could be both a person who, or a group that could say, this is a good thing to do, and in the very next breath say, but that wasn't a good thing to do, and not ruin the relationship.
Right.
Because what typically happens is, as soon as you say something bad, you go back into those old corners again, and the corners are so entrenched that you will never come back out again to the middle and meet. So the maturity is, I can criticize you and you can criticize me, and it's appropriate because we're not going to lose the fact that we have a trust that we can still work together.
Are you finding that the private sector is more willing to meet you halfway and accept that kind of relationship or not?
Certainly some sectors.
Mm-hmm. And some work to do in others.
Yes, it is in fact true. And the same would be the true at the government sector. I love the fact that for me, I will talk to pretty well anybody that wants to open a door and say we'd like to invite you in and have a conversation. We'd like to know your perspective on this. That in fact, that was David Suzuki's dream when he founded the foundation, was that one day people in government and business would say, this is a tough decision. Let's ask the David Suzuki Foundation what their idea is before we implement it. And we're actually seeing that more than we have before.
Excellent. Well, thank you very much for your time today.
My pleasure.